question.
Yes, ma'am.
Is it true that of the homicides that you talked about with the handguns earlier, that those are primarily and the majority of those are between people who know each other?
A lot of times.
Intimate partner
violence. A lot of homicides occur through people that know one another, the mm-hmm. domestic situations, friends becoming mad with friends.
Yes, and suicide.
Suicide is definitely, you know, people that are going to commit a suicide, they're going to use whatever means they can get. If you take their guns and they're dead set on doing it,
except
they'll
that
find
most,
another method.
Any other means besides the firearm is much more survivable. And we know that someone who survives a near-death experience with suicide does not go on to die by suicide.
Sometimes it's kind of a self-correcting problem. Once they inflict pain on themselves, they don't want to go back through that again.
Mm-hmm. At this point in time, bring in the audience. We have a gentleman here. His name is Larry Johnson. Larry, what did you have to say, and who would you like to direct that question to?
My question is directed to the right. I'm a veteran, having served in the military for 33 years, deployed to Vietnam, deployed to Saudi Arabia and Kuwait, and I've seen the lethality of high projectile assault weapons. I would like to have the right to explain the fascination for American citizens to have assault weapons. These are war weapons. And please explain why Americans need these weapons. You've talked around it a lot, but I'd like to get something specific.
Sir, can I ask you a question? And by the way, thank you for your service. The firearms that you used in Vietnam, were they semi-automatic?
They were M16s.
Fully automatic.
I carried an M16.
Full automatic firearms such that you deprive,
yes,
as long as you hold the
answer,
trigger,
I'm not
it will
here to
empty
answer
magazine.
Those questions. These are for you to answer.
Okay.
I've asked
well,
my questions.
The firearms, I will then. The firearms used in military situations are assault rifles. These are fully automatic weapons that will continue to fire as long as the trigger is depressed. Now, as much as the opposition would like you to believe that that's what's being banned, a semi-automatic firearm fires one shot per depression of the trigger, exactly as any other firearm, exactly as the revolvers you were describing right there, the single-shot shotgun. It's all the same principle. What they have done back in the early 1980s, a guy named Josh Sugarman at the Violence Policy Center now determined a strategy to confuse the public about the difference between machine guns and semi-automatic firearms, with the point that they could actually more easily obtain these bans. And what they have done since is to try and make you think that assault weapons, and this is a misnomer, is just a creation of the gun ban lobby, they want you to think that these assault weapons are the same as machine guns. They're not.
Representative Harris, are you confused about assault weapons?
I do understand the distinction between semi-automatic and automatic because I've actually shot a semi-automatic shotgun. But I do think that, and I think Gail probably knows more about this than I do, but as I understand it, we would never have had a massacre like we had in Newton or in Aurora, Colorado, or in Tucson, Arizona, if we hadn't had a gun that could have let off a number of rounds quickly. Because I understand that when Jared Lochner had to reload his high-capacity magazine, that gave the law enforcement officers a chance to halt the killing. So I think that this might be a semantical discussion. I think that there's probably a place for semi-automatic weapons. I do understand the distinction, but I don't think we need civilians to carry around AR-15s and AK-47s and whatever else they have access to. I understand the right to bear arms. I understand the Second Amendment, but I don't think that the founders of this country contemplated high-capacity assault weapons and the right to bear arms.
One thing, when the founders of our country created the Bill of Rights, with the Second Amendment as a part of, was they looked at other countries where the king, the ruler of those countries, had complete domination over their subjects, not citizens as we are. We're citizens, not subjects. But also looking at the way the Second Amendment was written for what was the best available technology for the citizens to protect them against attacks, protect them against their neighbors, because instead of having a centralized body or city, as most of them were used to in England and some other countries in Europe, we were spread out. So we need to have that type of response because law enforcement was that far away. But looking also, think about what they just came through during the Revolutionary War. The best military force in the world was the British Army. We had a group, the Continental Army, that fought bravely, gallantly, but it was the militia, the everyday citizen that, I don't want to say they created guerrilla warfare, but that was the turning point of the war. And when we put our Bill of Rights, it wasn't just more than protecting the citizens. It was a decree upon all the nations of the world. We have a military, but we also have citizens that single-handedly beat the best military in the world, because our citizens can act, react, and attack as well. And that in itself made us a very, very strong and powerful country.
Before we let you continue, Mr. Johnson.
No one has addressed the question that I asked about the fascination with these weapons. And that's really what I wanted to get to.
Could I maybe say something to address that? I know in law enforcement over the years, I've used automatic and semi-automatic weapons, assault rifles, various types of shotguns. We've transitioned through different types of handguns. A lot of the guys that came into law enforcement were ex-military. And that being a tool of our trade, we kind of, you know, I'm glad I never had to shoot anybody with it. I've pulled my weapon several times and never had to use it in 35 years. But I enjoy shooting. I still enjoy, now that I'm out of law enforcement, I had to turn in my toys or my tools back to the agency. But if I wanted to have an assault rifle to go out and shoot and to keep my skills, that's still a thing with me. It's not so much a fascination, because I'm over the fascination. It was one of my tools, and I had to be proficient with it. But if I wanted to have that, and I do it, I protect it, I keep it in a secure environment, why deprive me of that right to have it, or anybody else? Ex-military guys, they slept with, they carried that weapon day and night. They may still like to go shoot. I don't have to shoot at people anymore. I don't have to defend a fortress or anything, but I still enjoy keeping those skills. It's fun, like some people do other things, archery or anything else. So why deprive me of that as long as I'm lawful and law-abiding and maintain control of the weapon and protect it so that the wrong people don't get a hold of it?
Can we get that from someone here on the panel? Why would you want to deprive someone from having access to the kind of gun that Tim just talked about here?
One reason, Colorado and Arizona and Newtown, and you're talking about automatic weapons, when you can shoot 32 people in 27 seconds, and you can kill 20
these children. Killers have brought multiple firearms to the scene, right?
Children,
you do know that.
20 children that had, one of them 6 years old, that had 11 gunshots. A six-year-old stands this tall, 11 gunshots. What's left of that child? Have you ever thought about that?
And you're always talking about... Obviously, Sandy Hook is horrific. Nobody is arguing that.
You're always talking about the Second Amendment rights. What about the other rights of people? What about the rights of people that have mental health issues that can't get help because the North Carolina General Assembly has cut $48 million out of
the budget? What about the rights of 2.2 million people per year that use firearms for self-defense? 2.2 million times per year.
Take away from a group of people.
What about the rights of the poor woman who was broken into in Charlotte recently by three intruders, okay, and you're going to limit her to a 10-round magazine? That's three shots per intruder. Well, that's a much better hit ratio than the police generally manage.
You know, sure, we have to take one out, and the other two are leaving.
You're an expert on this, I take it.
Well, I take it you're an expert.
I'm just as much of an expert
because
as you are,
Paul. You're confusing the automatic weapon and a semi-automatic weapon because you take...
Actually, sir, with respect to being an expert on the defensive use of firearms, I am. I've been through Smith & Wesson Academy three times. I've been through Thunder Ranch. I've been through Front Sight Training Institute. I've been through Eagle Rock Training Systems.
I have a question for you. You thank that gentleman for his time in service, and yet you say that you need your weapons in case you have to take up your arms against the government.
And also for self-defense as well.
Well, he's one of those guys that you would be going after. Thank you, sir, for your service.
Well,
I would not be coming after you.
Actually, maybe yes and maybe no, because there are a lot of people in the military right now that say they would not uphold that law.
Really? So. Well, we have 90% of the American
people.
Excuse me. There are 90% of the American people right here, right now, today, that want these laws put in place. There are 75% of NRA members that want these laws put
Those are falsehoods. Point out the stats, please. Now, you can't just make this stuff up as you go along,
Gail. I am not making this stuff
please.
Up.
You're the exact reason why I worry about these firearms.
Oh, now we're going to... Now, who's the hater now, Chief?
Oh, listen. Anger and aggression.
Who's the hater now, Chief?
They do not go well with firearms.
Trust me, I do not hate. I think the problem is that why would you want to... We have a government to take care of us. We have a government. They protect us from people such as that.
Thank you. Thank you for so clearly elucidating your position.
I don't hallucinate. For the simple fact that we have a government that protects us and fights on foreign grounds to protect us.
That the majority of Americans voted for.
Can we take a time here to have another member of the audience pose a question? Marcus Kinley. Please introduce yourself, Marcus.
Marcus Kinley from Greensboro, North Carolina. Just one correction to something being said, that right now there is an ex-military member, an ex-former cop running around in L.A. shooting people on the street. He's 6'4" and weighs about 300 pounds. I would like to have a weapon to protect myself from that ex-military person. But back to my question. Yeah, we're here talking about gun control. And we know that there's misinformation about why the Second Amendment was there, because our revolution started at Concord and Lexington with the British trying to take the weapons away from the colonial militia, and that's the reason for the Second Amendment. But the thing that I think that we're missing here is why are these things happening? Joe Biden said this week in the Capitol that all of these gun laws that they're trying to pass would not stop any of these mass killings. That's on record. That's recorded. Okay, that's number one. Number two, Joe Biden also passed the law of gun-free zones. And since he did that, shootings in gun-free zones, or shootings in those areas that were, quote, gun-free, have quadrupled. They went up 400% when we instituted gun-free zones. So the man who instituted gun-free zones, the man who's pushing this legislation, says it won't stop any mass killings, that the gun-free zones that he created quadrupled the instances of people being harmed in this manner. Why aren't we talking about how that our government, because I run a prison ministry, sir, I go and see these people, I take the word of God to them. I understand who they are, and I know where they come from. We've destroyed the family in America. We say that parents are not, and as you so aptly put it, government will take care of us. There's fathers not in the homes taking care of these people. We've taken morals out of everything, from our television shows to our movies to our schools, where we can't have the Bible, we can't even teach the Ten Commandments or hang it on the wall. Why aren't we discussing the lack of the moral values of a society that devalues life with millions of abortions? In fact, there'll be 3,500 this week of innocent children killed. We've devalued life. Why aren't we discussing that and how to do that so that people appreciate life? And I think we'd see a lot less instances of violence. So I would ask this group, why are you not addressing any of those issues instead of just focusing on a straw man argument that even the vice president says won't prevent any of these instances in the future? Thank you.
Well, I think, first of all, I think the reason that we're not talking about that, because we're talking about gun control. That's the first thing. The second thing is that when you're going into prisons, there are opportunities for, there are criminals out there. They're going to be criminals regardless of what we do. You can't stop criminals, because they're going to be criminals in every society. Let me
stop a
citizen. But assault weapons.
Sir, there's no such thing as assault weapon. There's weapons, because assault weapons, you played with the semantics,
okay,
and it's
but
untrue.
Here's what I'm saying to you, sir. You cannot put these weapons in the hands of people and expect good results. So as you continue to talk about,
so we should take them away from the police.
Fatherless families. As you continue to talk about all of these other issues that are part of society.
And possibly
a part
a
of
point
every,
that answers the other man's question as
okay,
well.
Okay, as part of every person's society, you're looking at opportunities for jobs. Let's talk. If you want to talk about that, talk about jobs in the community. If you want to talk about that, you want to talk about jobs. We can talk about a whole lot of things, but we're talking about assault weapons to people.
No, I'm not. There is no such thing as an assault weapon, because you see, what you're trying to do is confuse the issue.
I'm not trying to confuse any issue. I'm telling you that no one needs a gun that can shoot multiple clips.
Sir, you raise an excellent point, and the point is we're asking the wrong question.
When we ask the question about gun control, we shouldn't be just talking about gun control. We should be talking about that fascination that you were mentioning right there, because that fascination comes from things like violent video games and the complete nihilism that many in that generation are adopting. You look at people like Gerald Loeffner, he was a perfect sociopath. Why was he a perfect sociopath? Why did he get a chance to perfect those skills, okay, and be so willing to take life looking at things like violent video games?
Video games are all throughout this whole society. We're not going to stop video games more than, we're not even going to stop this. Your conversation that you had, you're going to ban video games? Are you banning video games now? Is that what you're doing?
Minors, possibly,
is that the Second Amendment? Are you banning video games?
First Amendment. Why not?
Okay.
Oh, and so is the First Amendment right unlimited?
I don't
tell me my Second Amendment rights aren't unlimited. How about your First Amendment rights? After all, as you're so fond of saying, we can't yell fire at a crowded theater, can we?
North Carolina and buy a rifle. No one knows where it came from. No one knows where it goes.
And I have the right to vote, but I have to register to vote. I have to show my ID when I vote now.
No, you don't.
You will have to.
I certainly will.
Your side has made sure of that.
You can walk into a gun show.
This is not a Democrat or Republican issue. You're saying our side.
It's largely a liberal conservative.
You're saying our side.
Why do you think they have conservatives over here and liberals over there? Of course, this is not conservative liberal.
Kids get killed. It's not a Democrat or Republican issue. This is a person's issue. This is a community issue.
Insofar as certain members of this debate are not willing to base the debate on facts, yes, it is.
Well, I want to mention something. You know, he brought up his prison ministry. If his faith is so strong, then why would he need a weapon? And second of all, Jesus said, pick up the sword and you die by the sword.
I don't know how to address that, really. I just don't.
You don't? Let me ask this. Yeah. Why do you have two words that most far rights always say together, guns and God? Those two things should never be even put in the same paragraph, let alone the same sentence.
That's one perspective. There are a lot of religious people who would say otherwise. Personally, the religious perspective is not my strongest suit, so I'm not even going to comment on that one.
So I just wanted to weigh in.
They want to call me the religious right, but I'm really not.
I thought Mr. Kinley made a good point about pro-life, and I would love for pro-life policies to also continue after the birth of the child. And I've read a study this week that showed the high correlation between high rates of poverty and high rates of gun violence. And so I think that if we could spend a little bit of time as a society, perhaps as a government or the nonprofit sector to try and eradicate poverty or focus on that, I think we'd do a lot to reduce gun violence in this country. And I think that's just important.